especially involving the anterior chamber. Anterior chamber, which was not very much visible due to the lower frequency of the probes available. Now it is very nicely seen with high resolution probes. And it is now comparable and better than the ophthalmic B-scan. Ophthalmic B-scan has certain limitations. It has very small field of vision. And again, the anterior chamber is not clearly visible. So high frequency ultrasound is a very useful tool to evaluate eye and other structures. It is very rapid, non-invasive, accurate, and well-tolerated. There is no need for pupillary dilatation and direct ophthalmoscopy and can expedite the diagnosis and management of several acute eye conditions. We'll see them one by one. When this is useful, this is most useful when the ophthalmologist cannot see due to certain conditions, like either the eyelid is swollen after injury, or there is lens is opacified, there is hyphema, there is hypopyon, meiosis, or other vitreous opacities. And they cannot assess what's happening in the vitreous, what's happening in the retina. And in case of corneal opacities, they cannot see the anterior chamber itself. There can be certain limitations due to periorbital swelling or pain in injuries and other conditions. The scanning technique is very simple. We use our available high-resolution probe. That is, I use 7.5 to 12 megahertz probe, linear array transducer. Use a close eye technique, use good amount of ultrasound transmission gel, and scan in two planes, sag and transverse. Transverse is most yielding, but sometimes you can use a sagittal plane also. Ideally, you should use you should do ultrasound of both eyes, because it is very useful for comparison, and you can get an idea what is normal for that patient. And a tip for all is to keep your fingers or hand, rest of the fingers on patient's nose, forehead, or cheek, wherever you feel comfortable and wherever patient is comfortable. This will reduce the pressure on the eyeball, and that will give you better visualization. One more unique feature that has to be used while doing B-scan is a dynamic ultrasound or kinetic echography, as the ophthalmologists call it. This is to see the after movement. What is after movement? It is a description of posterior segment lesions mobility following cessation of rapid eye movement. You ask the patient to rotate the eye sideways or up and down and try to see whether the opacities or the membranes seen in the posterior chamber, they move and how they move. This helps us in differentiating amongst various pathologies that we will see in the next few slides. Certain care has to be exercised while doing B-scan. Whenever you suspect a globe rupture, the pressure may result in prolapse of the content. So you have to use very minimal pressure. And in immediate post-operative cases also, you have to take care of giving minimal pressure. And in such conditions, it is advisable to use a sterile gel. So how do you do ultrasound B-scan? We use two scan settings, high gain for anterior chamber and a low gain for a posterior chamber. In high gain, you can see the cornea, you know, iris, ciliary body, anterior chamber. And in low gain, you can see the posterior vitreous, retina, optic nerve, and muscles also. So you have to use proper magnification so that the eye is seen in almost 50% of your screen maybe. And you can use the focus to, as is seen here, the focus has to be very near or very in between 1 to 2 centimeters. And you can use the eye movement as seen here to see whether the contents, they are movable and how is their movement. Patient has to be trained for eye movement, and you can see here due to eye movement, these contents are very freely mobile. So how a normal eye is seen? A cornea is seen here as an anechoic or hypoechoic layer parallel to the eyelid. Anterior chamber is almost always anechoic. The iris and ciliary body are bright echogenic. The lens is anechoic in younger age group, and as the cataract develops, it becomes opaque. The iris and ciliary body that extends peripherally from lens to the periphery of the globe. Normal posterior chamber again is filled with vitreous, which is anechoic, and the normal retina you cannot differentiate from other layers. It is very snugly attached posteriorly. So you unless it is separated or there is edema, you cannot see it separately. The optic nerve is a hypoechoic linear structure that extends from the globe outside, and muscles you can identify on the side of the optic nerve. Normally, in many patients, you see floaters. Floaters, they are seen as scattered low intensity echoes or thin lines. They are most of the time broken and they move freely with eye movement. This should be differentiated from vitreous hemorrhage. Vitreous hemorrhage is, you see more number of echoes, they are more uniform, and they also show after movement. So what are the acute conditions wherein B-scan is indicated? Suspected foreign body, eye trauma, decreased vision or loss of vision, pain in the eye, and increased intracranial tension. Foreign bodies, yes, high resolution ultrasound is very useful in detecting and localizing foreign body. These bright echogenic acoustics, they are seen. Because there is fluid in the anterior and posterior chamber, we can see various pathologies very easily by ultrasound. So the non-radiopaque foreign bodies can also be visualized, and it has almost replaced X-ray as an investigation for detection of foreign body. Additionally, certain findings that hemorrhage or membrane separation that can be also picked up by B-scan. And additionally, it can pick up the extraocular foreign body also. So this is an example of patient had an injury and there was pain, swelling and redness. So the anterior chamber is normal. You can see the lens is also normal. But there is a linear echogenic foreign body embedded in the sclera. It has entered the vitreous and there is collection here at the distal end of the foreign body. And you can see there are numerous internal echoes indicative of vitreous hemorrhage that has produced due to this injury. So we have to adjust various gain settings and try to see whether there is foreign body within in the eye, in the membranes, and outside the eye. Because we really don't know whether they have what track they have taken up inside the eye. This is another example. It's very bright. This seen foreign body. It shows reverberation artifacts, and it has produced the separation of membrane in the posterior vitreous. And when the patient moves the eye, the membrane is freely mobile, and that indicates that it's a posterior vitreous detachment. This is another foreign body, again seen as very hyperechoic or very bright structure, and it is giving some posterior acoustic shadowing. You can see some membranes in the posterior vitreous due to the foreign body usually is inserted very rapidly into the eyeball, and definitely it produces damage to the eye. Another emergency is a globe rupture. The traumatic globe rupture is an ophthalmologic emergency and almost always requires surgical intervention. What are the ultrasound findings? There can be decrease in the size of eyeball as vitreous goes out, the anterior chamber is collapsed, and then the membranes, they buckle. And you can have abnormal morphological characteristics that depends on how the injury has occurred. And sometimes you can see the extrusion of eye contents, or sometimes there is compression from the orbital hematoma. So this is an example of a globe rupture wherein this anterior chamber is extremely shallow. You cannot see lens here. There are multiple membranes in the eye, and you can see that choroid is partially detached over here. In another plane, you can see choroid is detached from both sides and the lens is extruded outside the globe. So you need to see all orbit in both planes, and that is quite essential. This is another case of globe rupture, blunt injury to the eye. You can see there is a deficient break here in the posterior aspect of the globe, and the vitreous is moving in outside and going around the lens, around the optic nerve, sorry. On Doppler, we are just giving minimal pressure and try to see. You can see that to and fro movement of the vitreous there. And the optic nerve has also, the head has been severed due to the severe injury. This is another case of injury wherein the patient is off a kick. The IOL has been inserted, but you can see that the anterior chamber is shallow here, and there is a tear in where the lens is attached. And this is a comparable to other eye. The left eye shows normal anterior chamber, normal lens, and the right eye shows a tear in the lens. Coming to the inflammatory conditions, high resolution ultrasound has got very important role in their evaluation, and it is useful in management and follow up also. The ophthalmologists label them as anterior uveitis, intermediate, posterior, and pan uveitis. For us, the anterior uveitis, they involve the anterior chamber, and we can see the inflammatory changes in by doing the high resolution ultrasound. And the posterior uveitis, the retina and choroid are involved, and you get the inflammatory changes at that level. And pan uveitis, you can see that all both the anterior and posterior chamber and all membranes, they are involved. Anterior uveitis is quite common, accounts for 90% of the cases. The inflammation is around iris, part of ciliary body, and in the anterior chamber. Patient presents with pain, photophobia, redness, dimness of vision. In anterior uveitis, the slit lamp examination many a times gives the information. And if the cornea is opacified, an ultrasound biomicroscopy is the investigation of choice. But it is very limited. At least in our city, this is not available. So B-scan can give you significant information about these inflammatory changes. So this is a case where it's acutely inflamed anterior chamber. You can see that there is thick membrane that is over the pupil and lens. There are exudates in the anterior chamber and the ciliary body is quite thickened. So this for this, you need to bring your focus very near. You have to magnify and then you'll be able to see this in a better fashion. We are very used to see the posterior chamber pathologies, but for anterior chamber pathologies, definitely certain settings in your machine. Almost, I think all machines we have, we can do these settings and see the pathology in the anterior chamber. This is a normal anterior chamber. You can see normal lens, normal cornea, and iris and ciliary body. Whereas in this example, you can see the iris and ciliary body, see that exudates, they are seen as dots in the anterior chamber. And why this patient came? Because the cornea was opacified and ophthalmologist could not see anything inside. And we could give them information that that the anterior chamber is severely diseased here. Another case of anterior uveitis, here you can see that the iris is severely edematous. It has it has caused meiosis, and the angle has narrowed. This is called Bombay iris, and this is very specific condition of severe inflammatory changes in the anterior chamber. Another case, this is left eye is normal. You can see normal cornea. Right eye, the cornea is opacified, so the visibility to the distal structures is lost, and ultrasound comes to the rescue. You can see the thickened ciliary body, the debris on the pupil. There are some echoes here. Probably there is vitreous hemorrhage in the posterior vitreous. One more example, that the cornea is opacified. Nothing is seen to the ophthalmologist, and the ultrasound shows there is a vitreous hemorrhage. So this value addition, this information addition is given by ultrasound. This is another case wherein again the pupil is significantly edematous, but the size is normal here. There is a thin membrane that is crossing, and the distal eye is not visible to the direct ophthalmoscopy. Sometimes the cause of pain redness is outside the globe, and this is also very well picked up by ultrasound. So in this case, on the right side, the lacrimal gland is normal, and on the left side, you can see that it is bulkier than the right side, and it shows a good amount of vascularity. So this is also picked up when the clinical features are not very specific. Coming to the posterior uveitis, the choroidal thickening is significant finding in posterior uveitis. Normal choroidal thickness is around 1.1 millimeter. There are other signs like a T sign, where this fluid in the tenon space is wide and you can see it as T-shape. There are membranes, detachments, exudates, n number of findings you can get in posterior uveitis. And we can clearly document what's happening there. This is an example wherein the posterior vitreous shows significant amount of membranes and internal echoes. And the RC complex that we call it, a retinochoroidal complex, is thickened. It is 1.4 centimeter here. That indicates that there is a severe inflammation in the globe. Another example, the vitreous is full with internal echoes, dense internal echoes. and the coats, they are quite thickened, and then this can be labeled as vitritis or posterior chamber inflammation. The quantification of inflammation is possible. You can see how much exudates are there, where are the membranes, and how the coats are increasing size, and this is useful in follow-up also. Endophthalmitis is a sight-threatening condition. It involves almost all layers of the eye, and it is distinguished from panophthalmitis that it doesn't extend beyond sclera, and ultrasound can differentiate that. So because there is severe inflammation, you will see debris, you will see detachments, you will see edematous areas, you will see thickening, you will see fluid. All these findings can be seen on very beautifully on high resolution ultrasound. This is a post-operative case of pan end ophthalmitis, wherein you can see internal echoes in the anterior chamber. The lens has it has pushed the lens to one side, and there are a lot of exudates membrane in the posterior chamber as well. So almost all the membranes are involved, all both chambers are involved. So this is considered as an end ophthalmitis. You can see membranes in the posterior chamber as well. So this is a case where the patient was blind for so many years and suddenly developed, was diabetic, suddenly developed acute pain in the eye, and the ophthalmologist definitely couldn't see due to the exudates. And you can see the deformed eye globe. There are a lot of exudates, lot of multiple membranes in the posterior vitreous, internal echoes, the increased RC complex or retinochoroidal complex. There is this T sign. There is the widening of the optic nerve, and you can see fluid outside the sclera. So this is how you can differentiate it with endophthalmitis. This was a case of panophthalmitis. Some more conditions. This is common condition, vitreous hemorrhage, wherein there can be visual disturbance and visual loss depending on the amount of vitreous hemorrhage. And we can diagnose it as fresh, resolving, or organized vitreous hemorrhage depending on various findings. Initially, the RBCs are very uniformly spread. They may not be visualized on vitreous hemorrhage. Whenever a patient with diminished vision, acute diminished vision, or loss of vision with suspected vitreous hemorrhage comes to you, use a relatively high gain settings so that you can see that fine internal echoes in very acute cases. As they conglomerate, the vitreous echoes are visible. They can be seen as dots or lines, and we need to differentiate from floaters. So the dynamic ultrasound is useful. This is a case where you can see numerous internal echoes where they are very fine and they are filled the vitreous completely. This was a post-operative, post-cataract surgery case. And you can see those internal echoes on eye movement. They are very freely mobile and they show the after movement as is described. So this is how you try to differentiate with the floaters. As it resolves after a couple of days, RBCs, they conglomerate and they become a mass-like thing in the vitreous cavity. It can be a hypo or isoechoic. They get clumped together and still they have good after movements. As it gets organized, there's a deposition of fibrin and then it develops into membranes, bands, and we see them on high-resolution ultrasound. Because of bands, because of the membranes, the movement becomes reduced. Sometimes it gets attached to the retina, and then it's sometimes becomes difficult for us to differentiate between whether it is a posterior vitreous detachment or a vitreous hemorrhage. And when it gets attached, it can pull the retina and cause tractional retinal detachment. As seen in this illustration, this vitreous hemorrhage, while retracting, it pulls the retina and it causes a tractional retinal detachment. You see these B-scan pictures. There is an older vitreous hemorrhage. And now, due to its pulled or the traction, the one side of the retina is detached here. This is another example wherein a chronic vitreous hemorrhage is there. And you can see very thin membrane posteriorly that is a small membrane is seen, that is very minimal traction of there. Traction is causing that mild detachment of the retina. in this case. So the posterior vitreous detachment, the detachment is vitreous from the retina. The small posterior detachment almost go unnoticed, and they may be seen in asymptomatic patients always. The larger are associated with vitreous hemorrhage, or they are related to trauma or due to inflammatory processes. Many of them, they develop retinal tears, as we have seen, and if left untreated, they cause retinal detachments. So they are thin. Vitreous is very thin. It is seen as thin irregular membrane. Acute cases, you see that jiggly motion, or significant after movements, and as they become rigid, they resemble like a retinal detachment, and then they can have similar ultrasound features. And then you may need another ophthalmic evaluation or testing for coming to definitive diagnosis. So this is a case where you can see, this is called a multi-layered PVD. The vitreous itself has separated into multiple layers, and then it is showing some movement. It is not attached to the posterior pole, as the ophthalmologists love to call them. Next pathology is subhyaloid hemorrhage. It occurs in the potential space between the posterior vitreous detachment and the retina. It remains a fluid state for a significant amount of time. You see low intensity homogeneous ichthyosis with there may be layering. It has got a classical boat-shaped appearance in many cases. So this is an example wherein the rapid eye movement shows free movement of the posterior vitreous detachment, as well as the hemorrhage in between the retina and the detached vitreous. Next pathology that presents acutely sometimes is the retinal detachment. It can be primary or secondary, and it can be partial, complete, or tractional. Tractional, we have seen the complete retinal detachment is very highly reflective. It is typically V-shaped, and it is always attached to the optic disc. That is the way you differentiate in between the posterior vitreous detachment. The vitreous is thin, retina is thick. Retina is always attached, vitreous, most in cases it is not attached. Sometimes it may get attached. And the mobility, the retinal mobility is very restricted, whereas the vitreous moves very undulating fashion or jiggly fashion. This is case with posterior vitreous, the retinal detachment with the subretinal hemorrhage. This also can happen, and we can see them very easily. In this case, again, there is vitreous detachment and small tractional retinal detachment has occurred. So that can pull the retina, as I have said, and you can see the partial retinal detachment is quite common. This case has multiple pathologies. There is a partial retinal detachment. There is vitreous detachment as well. And you can see that the subhyaloid hemorrhage is seen on any addition. So sometimes you can get multiple findings. And then it is not always that only PVD will be there, only RD will be there. They are interrelated. And they, as seen here, you can see this posterior vitreous detachment, free after movements, but it is attached here. So that attachment can be at multiple places. Then you call it as tabletop attachment. It gets attached to multiple places and then pulls up a retina and causes traction or retinal detachment. So this is an example. See the membrane, they are relatively thin. They are attached almost at just lateral to the optic nerve. They are showing posterior significant after movements or undulating movements. So then the question comes whether this is posterior vitreous detachment or retinal detachment. So this is posterior vitreous detachment because it is thin. It has undulating after movements and it is not attached exactly at the pole. Right. Another case of chronic vitreous hemorrhage, there is complete retinal detachment and you can see hemorrhage in posterior to the retina. So identifying the pathologies are very easy and you can differentiate them. You should have proper settings and you can get the information very easily. This is a very minimal separation, not exactly separation. The retina is just, you can say it is edema, or it is just begin to separate. This also you can identify on B-scan or high resolution ultrasound very easily. Coming to choroidal detachment, it's not that common. associated with severe inflammation or severe trauma, and it is typically shows this format on B scan as against the V shape of a retinal detachment. This is an example of vitreous hemorrhage, and there is a partial choroidal detachment here. You can see the choroid has buckled. This is very classical choroidal detachment. On both sides, you can see this appearance, and there are membranes inside, and there is a internal echoes. You can see that the retinochoroidal complex is thickened. So this has happened. This is secondary to inflammation. That way, you can give the information to the ophthalmologist whether this is inflammation, whether this is trauma, whatever. So this is a chart. Almost all of us know, and we have discussed them, that how you can differentiate between posterior vitreous detachment, retinal detachment, and choroidal detachment, and how sometimes you may have certain confusions. In that case, you can always give differential diagnosis. So certain points I will just, before finishing, I will just revise. So always keep your finger on patient's head, forehead, or cheek to make yourself comfortable, make patient comfortable, and that reduce the amount of pressure on the eyeball. Because if you give more pressure, the anterior chamber will just get compressed because it's a gel or it's only fluid there. So it can get easily compressed. There is not much tension there. Use a lot of amount of jelly so that the jelly fills the lateral part of the surface below the probe, and you can see all complete picture very easily. In case of trauma, do not give any pressure on the eyeball. If you suspect globe rupture or a foreign body or postoperative cases, use sterile gel and limit the examination time as much as possible. There are certain limitations in vitreous oil. You cannot see anything posteriorly. In case there is air in the anterior chamber or within the eyeball, you may not be able to see anything. So to conclude, the high resolution B scan or high resolution ultrasound of eyeball is very handy tool in various emergency and acute conditions. It is very fast, cost effective, and it evaluates posterior segment of eyeball when fundoscopic evaluation is not possible. It can detect and characterize many anterior chamber pathologies. And this is many a times useful because the ultrasound biometry is very restricted availability. And you can give significant amount of information whenever there is the media is opaque or the cornea is opaque. It is helpful in preoperative planning and predicting postoperative vision. And it enhances the diagnostic yield. The newer probes, they are very high resolution. The amount of crystals they are focusing is becoming better and better, and that is giving us more diagnostic yield in the scan. Thank you for patient hearing. I once again thank ICRI for giving this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for an interesting talk on B scan in acute eye condition. Now, there are many questions to you for this. The